I do something cool. Just kick the camera again. This is getting to be habit. Like, I need to stop kicking the camera. Whew. Blah, blah, blah. Take a breath, take a breath, take a moment. Calm yourself and continue. Hello, everybody, and welcome back to Inside Number 23, my podcast, which is all about sewing and knitting and generally living the most crafty life possible. My name is Katie, and you can find me on all the various social medias as Miss Lavelli. And we also have a Ravelry group for the podcast, which you can find if you head over to Ravelry, go into the groups tab and search Inside Number 23. Welcome back. If you have been viewing for a long time, it's always so lovely to spend some time with you. And welcome. If it's your first time, hello, and I hope you enjoy spending a bit of time with me today. I'm coming to you as always from the UK, where I live in Hertfordshire, with my lovely husband Emrys and our cute as can be little pug puppy Rolly. And it's been a great week this week. It's been full of fun things and not so fun things, lots of hard work going on, but we've been very busy, as we always seem to be. And it's just flying by. Summer, to be honest, we're almost halfway through August now, if you can believe it. And this is episode 30! Yay! Episode 30! It feels like quite a milestone. Thank you for sticking with me through all of these episodes, through 30 episodes, and I think we're going to have a good one today. I've got some fun things to talk about. So I think we should get started with a little bit of administrative stuff before we get into all of the crafty goodness of the podcast itself. We do still have some coupon codes valid that I talked about last week. We have a coupon code from lovely Molly Klein Designs and also Yarn Seller Studios. And I will put the details for those in the show notes down below. And they'll also be included in the show notes that I share in the Ravelry group, the podcast group on Ravelry. In addition to those coupon codes, I also have a sew-along going on, which is the Holly Byrne sew-along. And I released the newest video of that this week. It was all about sewing pockets, and this coming week we shall be going on to sewing seams and seam finishes and all that good stuff. So if you haven't heard about the Holly Byrne Sew Along before, where have you been? But basically we are sewing together the sewaholic pattern of the Holly Byrne skirt, and I am following that through with step-by-step video tutorials to help people who may be slightly less experienced. And thank you to everybody for the really, really positive feedback that you've been giving. I really appreciate it. And yeah, head over to the Ravelry group again if you want more information about the sew-along, but I will pop the links for the playlist of the sew-along tutorials down below. And talking about playlists, I've been doing a little bit of housework for my YouTube channel, and the main thing that I've put into practice is that I finally created an Inside Number 23 podcast playlist, which basically gives you a list of every single episode that I have recorded in order. So if you do want to start from the beginning or just go back a few episodes or so, if you go to that playlist, it will have all of the episodes in order, as I said, and it just makes viewing a lot more easy and pleasant for you. Plus, I get the little thrill that I get when something has been super organised, which I just love. I've also created a couple of other playlists. There's one for the Holly Byrne Sew Along. There's some for my Outside Number 23 vlogging. They're just really easy. They play all of the episodes in order and they make things super simple for you. So do check those out if you just want to watch a little bit more of Inside Number 23. One more thing before we start the real juicy goodness of all of the knitting and crafting. I did just want to say a quick thank you for everybody who has contacted me regarding my general waffle segment at the end of last week's episode, which was all to do with self-confidence and self-doubt. And from what I can gather, a lot of you are feeling the same way, and that means a lot to me to have shared that experience with you. But when I get more personal in my general waffles, it is a little bit nerve-wracking, you know, and to get such a lovely, heartwarming response from you all just meant everything. So thank you so much from the bottom of my heart, and we're all in this together, basically. And yeah, we're a community and we share the good things and the bad things, and that's just what makes this whole thing so special. So thank you. Thank you very, very much. I do have a little treat for you in today's General Waffle, because we are going to be visited again by my lovely husband, Emrys, and we're going to be talking about some movie goodness. So stay tuned for that at the end of the episode this week. I told you it was going to be a good one. But let's move on, shall we, in the meantime, to a little bit of knitting goodness, I think would be a good thing to start with. So without further ado, it's time for What's on My Needles? I've been getting a fair bit of knitting done this week. I think one project in particular really feels like it has just exploded. Not literally, of course, but I do have more than one project on the needles at the moment, as you'll know if you are a regular viewer. So to start off with, I'm going to share a little bit of progress on my blueberry waffle socks. Now, these are socks that I'm knitting for my husband, and here they are. Not much progress has been made on these, I'm not gonna lie. I've maybe added a couple more rounds since you last saw them, so it's not particularly exciting. But they are the blueberry waffle sock pattern. I'm using this self-striping Regia yarn. I love this pattern, as I've said before. It's a real kind of brainless knit. It's really, really nice, very intuitive, and if I would just spend more time on them, I'm sure I'd get them finished a lot sooner. This is the second sock. I do already have the first one completed. And yeah, it's been knitted on my 2.25mm carbons DPNs, which are currently my DPN of choice. And yeah, not really much more I can say about those. So let's move on to something that has definitely made some very, very clear progress over the past week. Very excitingly so. And that is my Chuck sweater. As you might remember from last week, this is living in my adorable pink hazel project bag. And I love it. It's just, I just keep putting more things in it because you can see it's got the space. It's got space for loads and loads of stuff. What I have managed to do in this past week is pretty much finish the body of the sweater, which is here. Isn't it amazing? So when I last podcasted, I was about here in the cable repeat, and since then this is where I have ended up. So I have done the full two repeats of this main and beautiful cable pattern in the center, and I have actually done the rib around the bottom as well. And as you can see, what I've done at the moment, I've just popped it on waste yarn, and that's because I wanted to see how this would fit when I finished it. The size that I've made is the size small included in the pattern. It's the second size. And the reason that I did that was that the size, the medium, is a 37 inch bust. And my bust at the moment is around about 37 inches, but that was actual finished garment size with regards to this pattern when it came to the medium. And I do like my sweaters to usually have a couple of inches of negative ease around the bust. I find that because I've got quite a high difference between my bust to waist measurement, having a bit of negative ease around my bust makes things a lot more fitted, and it gives a style that I prefer. So I thought I'd give it a try with the smaller size, the size down. The issue with that was that the size small has a 34 inch bust, I believe, or even possibly a 33. And that's quite a lot of negative ease. And I was a little concerned that that would be kind of, you know, I'd be busting out of that sweater. But when I cast it on, and I cast on the right amount of stitches, because there's not much in it between the small and the medium size, to be honest, just from feeling it and looking at the way that it was coming up, I felt that the small would be appropriate. So I decided, you know what, this is such a quick knit. If I knit it in a small and it doesn't fit, it's not going to be the end of the world. I can always start again and do the medium. That wouldn't be too much of a problem for me. So I decided to go with the small. It all looked as if it was going well. The only thing that concerned me slightly was this is technically, it's a cropped sweater. It's a short length of sweater. So it's basically designed to hit at around about the waist when you wear it. And I wasn't sure if that was something that would be totally flattering. So I popped it onto waste yarn because what I wanted to decide is whether or not I should rip back and maybe do another repeat of this cable, because that would obviously give me some additional length, whether this would just look fine as it is. Maybe I should add extra rows of rib around the bottom. Maybe that would help. So what I'm gonna do now is just pop this on so that you can see how it's fitting and kind of how I'm deciding to progress with it. So this is a bit of a strange ensemble, isn't it? But this gives you an idea of how this sweater is basically fitting on me and my measurements in comparison to the measurements of the pattern. And I would like to say straight away, I did get pretty much exact gauge with my 5mm needles, which is what is recommended in the pattern. So this is basically the recommended gauge for this particular pattern with this weight of yarn, which is Aran weight. And the yarn I'm using, by the way, didn't say, is a Knitpicks Aran weight, and it's in the Cadet colour, which I think is really quite nice. But let me kind of stand up and scooch back a bit so that you get a better idea of how this is fitting, because this is not much to see at the moment. So this is how the sweater is fitting at the moment, and I've got to say, I am really quite happy with this. Pretty much spot on where my waist is at the bottom of the cable pattern and where the rib starts. So where this rib is hitting is right on my hips. And to be honest, I kind of like it. It's kind of like a little cinched in detail. And then this rib just sits just over my kind of my little belly at the front. And also this is like directly on the curve of my hip. So if that's where my waist is, as you can see. So I think that the style, the shape is actually very flattering on my body. When we're talking about bust, this is the small size, and technically I'm supposed to have between 3 to 4 inches of negative ease on this. I don't know about you, but this doesn't look like 3 to 4 inches of negative ease to me. It just looks like a tiny, tiny bit. So I'm really happy that I went with the size small. In terms of the way that it's fitting at the back, it's not kind of pulling or dragging or anything like that. There's a little bit of excess around the neckline, but that will be taken care of when I pick those stitches up and I do the finishing. So basically, I am really, really happy with how this has turned out. And from just popping it onto the waist yarn, I can see that it's going to fit nicely. The one thing I would say is, if you can see, this 1x1 rib is stretched quite a lot out. And so when I do the bind off, I'm going to want to make sure that I do something that's going to give us this flexibility, because as you can see, that is relatively stretched around my little front pouch here and my hips. But other than that, I am really happy with how this is looking. And considering that I was worried that it would be too tight, I think that it was kind of ridiculous that I was worried that it would be too much negative ease. But I'm going to take this off now. And I'm going to stop kind of pointing at my chest area. So, yay! Getting in and out of clothes when it's hot and muggy, particularly when they're wool, is not the easiest thing to do. I have really, really enjoyed making this pattern. I'm a big, big fan. This is by Andi Satterlund, and I could see myself making a lot more of her patterns, because this really just suits my style, my aesthetic. It's been very satisfying to do the cables, because if you've been with me for a while, you'll know that I'm a huge cable fan. I absolutely love cabled knitting. So to do something like this, which was relatively involved, I'm not gonna lie, particularly these central sections are quite involved. But it's just so satisfying when you have it finished and you can see how beautiful it is, and I know it's gonna block out beautifully. And you never know, considering how quickly this has shot off the needles, considering that it wasn't even half this done last week, I might have a finished object soon. You never know. I'm a big fan of this sweater. I could see myself making 100 in 100 different colours, because it's just so functional. I could see myself throwing this on over any number of different outfits that I have. And yeah, I'm really happy with it. And considering as well that it came from stash, so it feels like getting a free sweater, if you know what I mean, because I'm getting out of the stash rather than buying new yarn to knit it. Just makes it even more fun. And yeah, really happy, and it's really gorgeous. And cabled knitting for the win, you guys. Cabled knitting for the win. So I have one more work in progress to share with you this week in terms of my knitting. It hasn't made an appearance on the podcast for a little while. So for all of those of you who are a little bit new, you may not have seen this before. For my older viewers, you'll probably be like, ah, I wondered when this was going to be coming back out. It's living in my Molly of a Homespun House project bag, and it is my Cozy Memories blanket, which is huge. I'd forgotten how much work I had done on this. The reason that I got this out and started it again was in the last couple of weeks, I've been lucky enough to receive lots of mini skeins from lovely viewers of the podcast and friends and everything, and it just really just got my Cozy Memories blankets juices flowing again, and I knew that I needed to pick this up and work on it, and it's so much fun. Even though it's a little bit hot and muggy, I still don't have a problem working on this blanket. It brings me so much joy. Look at all these colours, aren't they amazing? Oh, I just love it. I love it, I love it, and I'm really happy to have picked it up again. And I also thought for viewers of the podcast, like I said, who are maybe a little newer and haven't seen this, I'll just give you a quick refresh as to how I personally knit my Cozy Memories blanket. All I have done is I selected all my yarns, because the way that I do my memories, my Cozy Memories blanket, is that I always select exactly which yarns are going to go into the next row, and then I'll just knit them all in order. So I've already got my order all picked out. The first one that I've started is this corner one, which is in this incredible, it's not kind of coming across properly on the video, but it's neon orange, and I'm obsessed with it. It's making me so happy to have this bright, bright pop of orange, which is going to be just diagonally across from this crazy skein as well. Let me just talk you through how I put my blanket together. So in terms of the structure of the blanket, so the order in which I knit my squares and the way that they go together, I do follow the plan that was laid out by the amazing Kemper Wray of Junk Yarn in her My Coziest Memories, I think it's called. It's a free pattern on Ravelry. However, I do change things up in terms of pretty much everything else. So needle size, I use 2.5mm needles. Again, I use KnitPro carbons. So I have two of these, which live in my project bag. I cast on 51 stitches with each one of my squares. So that's basically 25 on each edge, plus one as my center stitch. The technique that I use creates this center seam, which you can see along here, the center seam for each one of my squares. To create this crease in the front on the right side of my blanket, I do a center double decrease on the right side, which is basically a decrease which involves the center three stitches on your right side row. You slip two stitches as though you were going to knit two together, so it's slip two stitches knitwise together. You knit the next stitch, and then you pass those two stitches that you slipped over that knitted stitch, which gives you this lovely center kind of seam. And on the wrong side, when you get to that bundle, which is basically made up of three stitches, you purl it. So it continues this lovely center crease, which I absolutely love. The other thing that I do is I slip the first stitch of every row purlwise, and I knit into the back of the last stitch. And what that basically does is, if you can see here, can you see how these stitches are so kind of defined and pronounced on the edge? It means that when you're picking up your stitches to add more squares onto the blanket, it's so much easier to pick them up, because you can literally just slip your needle between two of these stitches at a time, so just kind of through those two little stitches, and you know that you're picking up that stitch completely. And for me, it just makes things a lot simpler. But yeah, I'm really excited to be knitting on this again. It does make me really, really happy. It's kind of me, I think, willing for autumn to come, which I know is a little bit silly because it's not gonna come for a while, but autumn is my all-time favorite season. I love it so much. My birthday is at the end of September. It's just the most special time of year. I look forward to it all the time. I'm entirely an autumn baby, and this is kind of my heart calling out to autumn and saying, please come, because I love you so much. So that's all the knitting that I've been working on this week. So we're going to move on now to what would a bookworm do? And yes, you're probably thinking, but Katie, we had a What Would a Bookworm Do segment last week, and usually this is something that I don't include every week on the podcast, but you guys, I have some fun things to share with you, and I just couldn't wait for another week to go by before I talked about them, because I'm so excited. So I made some new bookie purchases over the past week, and the reasoning behind these purchases is kind of twofold. Firstly, I went to see a movie this last week, which I've been waiting to see for a very long time, and it's one of the movies that I'm going to be talking about later with Emrys in our general waffle section, so I don't really want to talk about it too much now. But this is a movie that's based on a comic book series, and after seeing that movie, I decided without a shadow of a doubt that I wanted to read the graphic novels of this particular series. I have never actually read a graphic novel before. I have never purchased one. It's something that I've always wanted to do since I was really, really young. But as I was growing up, I didn't really have a large group of friends who were into comic books and graphic novels. And so I felt like I was going to make a wrong decision, and that really stopped me from buying anything for a very, very long time. I just felt like I was going to get it wrong and buy something that I didn't like. And so for all of these years, you know, I'm 28 years old, I had never purchased a graphic novel, but this moment, seeing this film, made me decide I am going to make a purchase, I'm going to buy this graphic novel, and it's going to happen. But when I went to the shop to buy said graphic novel, I remembered, as though a little voice were going off in my head, another podcaster who I absolutely adore, which is Candace of the Pinfeathers and Purls podcast. And she recommended a graphic novel in one of her podcasts. And this graphic novel was one that she said was not just amazing for itself, but also was kind of a really good graphic novel if you're not really into that thing or you haven't had a huge experience of graphic novels. And she went, this will be the thing for you. So when I went to the shop and I saw this novel there, I went, I really need to buy this as well. So I did. And I am now the proud owner of graphic novels. And you guys, bit obsessed. The first one I'm going to kind of do a quick share, but I am going to be talking about it a little bit more later in the episode, but the film. Love this. This is volume one, so I've already finished this one, but I am going to be putting that down because there will be more about that later. But the one that Candace recommended is Saga. From the second that I started reading this, I'm obsessed, you guys. I am obsessed. And I don't have a huge amount of disposable income at the moment. It's a, you know, it's something I have to ration myself. And it's hard because now, as well as wanting to buy all of the yarn and all of the fabric and do all of that, all I can think about is buying more of these. It's wonderful. One thing that I would say about both Suicide Squad and Saga, they are of adult content, shall we say. They are not for our younger viewers, and I wouldn't recommend them to anyone. Probably, I would say if they were going to have a rating, it would probably be around about a 15, maybe slightly more for some particular things that happen within them. But that doesn't bother me. I am not turned off by that type of thing at all. If you are, they may not necessarily be for you. Suicide Squad, I think, is very much in, you know, it's based on a comic book. It's very much in that superhero genre. If you're a fan of that, I think you will really enjoy that graphic novel. Saga, however, I honestly think that Candace hit the nail on the head when she was talking about this, when she was saying it's probably for anybody who enjoys adventure, who enjoys a good story, who enjoys sci-fi fantasy elements to things. The story is so addictive. I'm already completely hooked and I'm not even halfway through this first volume. And the reason that I'm only halfway through is that I'm rationing myself because I love it so much. I know that I could sit down in a day and devour the entire thing, but I'm not allowing myself to do that because I want it to last. Suffice it to say, I feel utterly converted to graphic novels. I am embracing my inner geek. Genuinely, it's lovely to be kind of approaching 30 and to find something completely new to me that's bringing me so much joy and happiness, and it's brilliant. So thank you, Candace, for giving me that little nudge that I needed. But you guys, graphic novels are where it's at. I love them. And yeah. So moving on from, shall we say, slightly geeky, nerdy literature into a really fun segment, which is probably my favourite. You know, I mean, I love them all, but this one, it's fun for everyone, and that is stash enhancements. And I've got to say, this has a definite geeky twist to it as well. This is probably my nerdiest episode ever. And, you know, I had an entire episode that was just dedicated to Harry Potter, so that is saying something. But you know what? I'm gonna let my geek flag fly. I am getting my geek on right now, and I'm loving it, and that's just the way things are gonna be this week, apparently. You know, multifaceted, beautiful people that we are, we can be interested in all the things, and that is just amazing. So, stash enhancements do come with a little bit of a story attached. As you'll know from kind of the last couple of weeks, I did go to Fiber East and I made a lot of purchases. I had some beautiful things and I'd pretty much said to myself, no more yarn. And then the thing happens that always tends to happen when you say that you're not going to buy anything. You go on Instagram and you see that someone, a yarn dyer that you absolutely adore, has come up with some of the most incredible colorways you have ever seen. And this particular dyer was lovely Steph of London House Yarns. And I'm a big fan of Steph. I've bought from her previously. In particular, her Harry Potter colorways are things that I am obsessed with. I have just up here. This was a previous purchase. This is one of her sock duos, which is in the Yule Ball colorway, self-striping. I also have her the Four Founders colorway, which has all of the Hogwarts school colours in a self-striping yarn. She is amazing. I think she is so good at what she does, and it's really, really nice to have a UK-based dyer who is not just doing these incredible self-striping, but also using some really fun pop culture references, because I do feel like that's where we're slightly lacking in the UK. We have incredible dyers, don't get me wrong, but finding someone like Steph who does these kind of colorways is just really special. So I think she's amazing. And if you can get hold of any of her yarn, you will not be sorry, because it's so lovely and oh, I love it so much. But anyway, that's going back up in the stash. But basically, within the space of about 3 days or so, I had seen not just one, but two colorways of yarn of Steph's that I had to have. I just had to have them. It was not a question of, oh, maybe I'll be able to live without that yarn. I had to have them. It was also a little bit stressful because Steph is in very high demand. So if you want to get hold of some of her yarn, you need to be on it. When she does her upload, you need to be at the computer, you need to be ready and waiting, and you need to make those purchases, and you need to just check out so you're not cart jacked. And I was just thinking, oh, do I really want to do this? Do I want to go through this? Because it's not just needing the yarn, it's this additional anxiety of having to get it before anyone else does, because it's in such high demand. But I thought, I'm gonna log on at the right time, I'm gonna try and make the purchase, and I'll see whether or not I can get one or other of these colorways that I'm absolutely in love with. And you guys, I got them both. Oh, I felt so good. I literally felt like a checkout ninja, because I didn't just get these yarns. I got the ones that had already been dyed up, so they weren't even pre-orders, so I knew that they would be sent out to the post to me like right away, and I was just like, yes! Oh yeah, nailed it! I got the yarn that I wanted. Honestly, I felt like I needed to do a lap of victory after making this purchase. I was so happy. But without further ado, let me show you what I purchased from the amazing Steph of London House Yarns this week. So the first colorway that came up on Steph's feed that I really, really needed to get hold of is something that's based on a current craze that seems to be affecting a lot of people, including my lovely husband, which is Pokemon Go. Yes, Steph, in her amazing wisdom, managed to create the most perfect Pokemon-themed self-striping yarn that you have ever seen. It is called Catch 'em All, and here it is. So you can't really tell from the skein just how amazing this is. I mean, don't get me wrong, it looks beautiful. You can see you've got the red and the black in there. There's also quite a lot of white, and then there's a whole array of these kind of pastel tones. But what I'm gonna do is put a little picture up here so that you can see how this stripes out, because it's like a Pokeball and then all of the colours of the Pokemon kind of next to it. And when I saw that picture on Instagram, I just lost it. I just had to have this yarn, and I got it, and it's perfect. That is the first colourway. Pokemon themed. I must say, in terms of Pokemon Go, I'm not actually playing myself. Emrys is obsessed. He loves it. And I know that a lot of people are as well. A lot of my friends are playing, but I haven't yet given in. I've downloaded it, I just didn't get beyond the stage of downloading it, but you never know. I would just want all of the cute ones. I wouldn't necessarily want all of them. I'd be happy if I had, you know, Pikachu and Jigglypuff, maybe Clefairy, Bulbasaur. I think everyone's always mean about Bulbasaur and says he's rubbish, but I think he's adorable, so that's pretty much how I would play Pokemon. I'd be like, I'll rescue the ones that nobody else wants. The second purchase that I made from Steph was a bit of a surprise, because this was something that I discovered on her Instagram feed after having already decided that I was definitely going to try and get her Pokemon yarn. And it just took my breath away. It was so beautiful. And again, very geeky, but going back to my heart of hearts, this is a Harry Potter themed yarn. Here it is, you guys. This is the Cursed Child. It's a perfect match to the cover of the newest book that's been released, The Cursed Child, which is the script of the play that's currently on in London. And I wish that I had a copy of that book here so that I could put this yarn up next to it and you could see how perfect they are and how this just matches 100%. And it's so stunning. It literally, when I saw that picture on Instagram, my breath was completely taken away about how stunning it was. But I don't have a copy of Harry Potter and the Cursed Child because I'm making a conscious decision that I'm not going to read it until Emrys and I go and see the show this December, because we are lucky enough to have tickets to go. I don't know how long I'm going to be able to stick with this, you guys, because I know that there are spoilers out there. I know that people are being really, really good and not saying anything that happens. And please, please, for the love of goodness, do not spoil this for me. If you do know what's happened and you've read the book, or you might have even seen the show already, please don't spoil it for me, because I'm so desperate to just go to the show without any knowledge of anything. And I really hope I can continue that. It's not too long now, you know, a good few months or so, but it's not as if we were waiting for a year, which I know that a lot of people are in terms of buying their tickets, because that's how sold out this show now is. I'm trying really hard not to buy a copy and not to read it, because I don't want spoilers. So for me, this was the perfect solution, because I get a little bit of Harry Potter and the Cursed Child, which is so gorgeous. I mean, oh, but I don't have to live with the fact that the book is in the house and I haven't read it, and yeah, you know. So yeah, my two purchases from London House Yarns, I am so happy with them. And without a shadow of a doubt, I just recommend Steph's yarns so much. This is now this is number three and number four of the yarns that I've purchased from her, and every single one of them is so special and so beautiful, and they're so squishy. So if you can buy from her, I know it's difficult, but follow her on Instagram. She's very good about letting people know when she has updates, and it is a bit of a bloodbath, I'm not gonna lie, with people getting cart jacked and all kinds of things. But if you can get your hands on some of her yarn, it's so worth it. It's worth it. You know, I had to fight for these, and I'm so happy that I did. So you guys, it's about that time in the podcast where we move on to the general waffle segment. But like I said, I have an extra special segment for you this week, because Emrys and I are going to be talking all about films. You know, we've gone from graphic novels to geeky yarn to even more geeky films. So it's been a really, really good episode. I really enjoyed it. We actually filmed this segment last night after I got home from work. So we are going back in time. Woo! going back in time for this, but I really hope that you enjoy this week's general waffle. I'm going to hand over now to Emrys and Katie of the past, and yeah, I'll see you then. Cheers. Hello, everybody. Welcome back, Mr. Matthews.
Hello.
I'm here with Emrys, and we're going to do a little bit of general waffling today.
General waffling?
Doesn't really work.
I love that. I think we both did it. It was good.
And we're going to be talking about some films that we have been to see recently.
Movie films.
Mm. As you will know, if you're a regular viewer of the podcast, I am a huge, huge lover of film, and in particular going to see films at the cinema. I absolutely love it, and we have been lucky enough to see quite a few films recently. Mm-hmm. So I thought it would be fun if we kind of did like a mini review kind of segment in today's general waffle. We're going to be talking about three different films that we have seen. So I'm going to say right at the beginning here, there may be spoilers ahead. There will be spoilers ahead. Also, as another little disclaimer, it is Saturday night. I have been at work all day, and therefore
beverages.
This was in order. This was my reward for a long, hard day at work. So it's nice to come here and be able to talk to you guys about something fun after a long week. Let's just jump into it then.
Should we talk about them in the order we saw them?
Yes.
Okay.
So the first film that we're going to be talking about is Ghostbusters. Who are you going to call?
Dropping your notes on the floor.
This version of Ghostbusters is obviously the reboot of the original 80s version of the Ghostbusters.
It has a really good cast.
It's starring Melissa McCarthy, Kristen Wiig, Kate McKinnon and Leslie Jones as the Ghostbusting quartet. And then it has a really good kind of ensemble cast with lots of different cameos. Chris Hemsworth as an, shall we say, interesting role in this film.
Yeah.
What were your thoughts on Ghostbusters?
I like the film overall. I enjoyed it more than I was expecting to.
I would agree, to be honest. I thought it was really fun. I enjoyed it. I think it had a lot of entertainment value. The problem that I had with it was I wish that they had done more with what they were doing. I was disappointed with Melissa McCarthy and Kristen Wiig, which I didn't expect to be. Their characters kind of bored me a little bit from
they were just a
time.
Bit general, weren't they?
Yeah.
But I think we're both in agreement that Kate McKinnon is the best thing
my
in the film.
I love Kate McKinnon. There is a moment, I won't say exactly kind of what happens because I think it's the best moment in the film, but you know the moment I'm talking about at the end.
Yeah.
With it's like the Kate McKinnon moment. The one thing that really stuck out to me that I think is of the most importance with this movie is I can't remember the time that I have seen pretty much an entirely female-led film where not a single storyline is one or other of those characters moping over a boy. Or, I'm not married yet. Or, oh, I was in this relationship, but now it's not worked out properly. And now I need to go and find my love. And, oh, wait, I didn't actually need a boyfriend because I'm enough just myself, you know. And the best thing about this film was that it was these incredibly intelligent, go-getting women who were just living their lives and loving their life. And not a single moment did they mention the fact that apparently, from what you can kind of gather, they all looked as though they were single. Young girls are going to see what is essentially kind of a superhero film where these women are, like I said, incredibly intelligent, incredibly cool, and yet they're not in figure-hugging, boobs-out, legs-out, superhero outfits.
They're attractive, but they're attractive in a realistic way instead of in that kind of, like, magazine sort of unreachable, unrealistic
way. Real, they are real women who do look beautiful, but that is not the only thing that defines them. There is so much more to them than that.
Yeah.
And I just wish that they had been able to develop those characters more, because it's the same with any kind of first film. You see a little bit, but you don't get everything.
This kind of film is doing something important. And even if it doesn't do it 100% amazingly, it does it like you know, it does 80% amazingly. And it is worth seeing solely for that, if nothing else.
Yeah. So in terms of marks, I am going to give out of 5 stars, because we're classy like that. I'm going to give Ghostbusters 3 stars.
I'm also going to give Ghostbusters 3 stars.
3 stars, yay! So definitely worth going to see. Not a perfect film by any stretch of the imagination, but like I think it's important. I think it's an important development in filmmaking history, and it's just fun.
Yeah, it's a fun
film. It's a fun movie.
Yeah.
So the next film that we saw was one that I have been so excited about for such a long time, and that's Finding Dory. Finding Dory! And I'm so happy that I've finally seen it. But before we even talk about Finding Dory,
we need to talk about the short before Finding Dory.
We need to talk about Piper. What
was it? Piper, that was it, yeah. So on comes this lovely short film, which is probably about 2-3 minutes, called Piper, which is about a bird.
Don't say anything more than it's just about a little bird.
Okay, it's
because
about a
it's
little
so perfect,
bird.
I don't want to, I couldn't spoil it.
I thought it was really beautiful, but when I turned to Katie at the end of it, she was in tears.
I was sobbing.
Full sobbing.
I think it's worth going to see Finding Dory just to see that. That's how much I loved it.
If you haven't seen it yet, we'll try not to spoil anything, but the basic story is about Dory trying to track down her parents.
I think it's a really fun story because it is about Dory finding her family, her parents, but it's also, it is about her finding herself as well, like finding Dory. It's this kind of, because she is such a kind of comedy element in the first film. She's very much a secondary character to Marlin and Nemo, who were like the main focus. And in this, she does come into her own as her own character and she recognises her own strengths as well as her weaknesses. You know, it's a very typical Pixar thing. You know, it's about accepting every side of yourself and knowing that your weaknesses can actually be strengths because they set you aside. They set you apart from other people. They have an incredible voice cast in this film.
Yeah,
really, really good.
I cannot remember the names of everyone, but there's the octopus guy.
Ed O'Neill,
yeah.
Who's
from Modern Family and many other things.
Hank the Octopus. Mm-hmm. Some really nice new characters in, and they just managed to slip them in seamlessly amongst the more established characters, and that was really, really lovely. If you enjoyed Finding Nemo, you will enjoy Finding Dory. I think they're on par.
Yeah, so do I.
I really think that they are equal in how good they are and how special they are.
What score would you give it?
I'd give it 4.5 stars.
Ooh, what would Dory do? 4 stars.
4 stars, yeah. So we liked that one. Go see Finding Dory. Okay.
Oh, now it's the interesting one.
So the most recent film that we went to see is Suicide Squad. And the idea behind Suicide Squad is that they put together this group of criminals. I read somewhere that if you were going to do a drinking game, if you took a shot every time that Will Smith said bad guy, you'd probably be quite inebriated within the first 10 minutes of this film, because that's, they are trying to hammer it home.
We're bad guys.
We're bad guys. They're
You're
the bad,
a bad
guys.
Guy.
You're a bad
we're
person.
We're all bad guys.
We're
here.
Bad people and we do bad things, you know? But that's the main idea, is it's a elite task force, as it were, called the Suicide Squad.
And they can be called in to take care of any difficult situations, and if they all get killed or something happens,
they just throw them under the
it
bus.
It doesn't matter,
in
because
the words of Amanda Waller.
And the incentive for these bad guys is that they get their prison sentences reduced.
Yes.
Or they get like certain luxuries, things like that.
There's a whole variety of different characters. So you have Deadshot, it's played by Will Smith, Harley Quinn, the Joker's girlfriend, who is played by Margot Robbie. And then you also have some like much less well-known characters. There's a guy called Slipknot. There's Captain Boomerang, Diablo, Killer Croc. There's a lady called Katana. And then you have, who's the other one? Oh yeah, the Enchantress, June Moon, also known as the Enchantress. And then you have their kind of keeper, who's Rick Flagg, who works for the government, and he's a soldier.
That's a good impression.
Yeah, that's kind of what he's like.
And the Joker's in it as well.
Yeah. We're going to come to that, aren't we?
Whilst there are parts of this film which are good and enjoyable, most of this film, from my point of view, is not very good and not very enjoyable. Some of the biggest flaws with this film are these characters are all meant to be criminals who have done terrible things, and they paint them all far too sympathetically. The plotline generally is not great. The film has fallen foul of some pretty terrible editing, which has made parts of it not make sense.
This is interesting because Emrys thinks that I am in love with the Suicide Squad. And to a certain extent, I must admit, after seeing this film, all I have been able to think about has been Suicide Squad. So much so, I started reading the graphic novels and I've got
Pops.
I got my Pop. This is my first ever Pop figure, you guys. Isn't she awesome? I'm really excited about the fact that I'm collecting these now. I'm so happy. But yes, this is Ms. Harley Quinn.
Mother We've ordered Robbie. The Joker, but he's not arrived yet.
I'm so upset that my Joker isn't here yet, but he will be here and he
feels
will...
oddly representative of this film.
The Joker's just not here.
Yeah, he's like, oh, but he was in all the trailers.
Yeah,
so. Where is he?
A lot of people said that they haven't liked Jared Leto's Joker. And I would disagree because I really, really liked his representation of it. I think in a world where we're much more used to, you know, the Batman Begins Dark Knight side of Batman, which is very gritty and real and kind of...
good.
Yeah, I mean, it's good. I'm not saying it's not, but it's very dark and it's very realistic. The Batman that I grew up with was not like that. And I feel that Jared Leto's Joker is much more a showman and everything's over the top and it's all for effect. But I don't think that's wrong. I just think that's a different interpretation of the character. And I personally enjoyed what I saw. And I think that people struggle with it because there wasn't enough of it to fully develop him as a character and show why he was like that. But I understood it. See, I'm going to put the Joker to one side. I'm going to put a pin in the Joker.
He'd probably quite like that.
I think he would enjoy that.
Yeah.
And I'm just going to pop a pin in the Joker and pop him to one side for a second because I think... the Joker and my thoughts and feelings about that whole thing is separate from the rest of the film.
Okay.
Even though there are a lot of things about this movie that, like I've said, have kind of stuck in my brain and they're whirring round and round and round and I haven't been able to let it go, and I do think it's the start of a new obsession for me. This is not a perfect film by any stretch of the imagination. I was writing down some notes as my opinions about the film earlier today, and what I've written down is poor villain, weak storyline, plot holes, and the stakes do not seem high enough. The main villain in this movie is June Moon. Basically, she's possessed by the spirit of this old enchantress thing, and then it takes over her body, and then suddenly she wears a bikini and does this a lot. That's Harley Quinn. I'm so evil, I'm so evil. That's literally how evil her character gets. It's a mess. That part of the story is a complete and utter mess, and because I feel what they really, really needed was some form of recognised villain or something for them to go up against, because there are so many characters in this. You know, when we were talking about the members of the Suicide Squad, there are so many people that they are trying to cram into this movie. There's too much going on and it ends up being really, really messy. One of the main issues is that this has just gone through an absolute nightmare of edits. There's been all these stories coming out since the film was released about additional footage for a whole plethora of characters. But what I would say is that a lot of people have been getting frustrated because of these reasons. They're like underdeveloped characters, we didn't know where they came from, we didn't know what was going on with them. And I think you would only really care about that if you had some interest in these characters. And I think that one of the redeeming features of this film is that the actors do incredibly well with what they have. You know, they did as much as they could possibly do because they're a very, very talented cast. But the problem was that what they were given to do, and also the extent of the cuts, which kind of reduced their characters down to the just the tiniest little bit.
Two-dimensional.
Was, it just left them being nothing. So,
should we talk about the editing a bit?
Yeah.
So it certainly, from what I've read and from what I understand, it feels like Batman vs. Superman came out. It wasn't particularly well received, and that set some alarm bells for this film, and a lot of editing and changes were made. Give you one prime example. There is a part in the film, again this is spoilery, where the Joker apparently dies and Harley Quinn is kind of sad for about two, three minutes. And then after that, she just kind of cracks on and doesn't seem to be that fussed for the rest of the film.
That's what we were saying about the stakes not being particularly high. Because obviously,
that's
actually
nothing to do with the stakes, it's to do with the editing, because the stakes were higher in the sense that originally she didn't think he was dead. So that was why she doesn't seem fussed.
She thinks he's dead
momentarily,
but should we actually just talk about the Joker and Harley Quinn? Because I feel like that's a whole topic.
That's what you want to talk about as well.
And that is what I want to talk about.
There we go.
Been
leading up to this.
Probably something that you're aware of if you're a regular viewer of the podcast and you know the type of things that I like. Gothic horror, gothic romance, like that is my, that's my jam. It's my peanut butter and jam. That's what I thought my jam meant for a really long time. Like, I love strawberry jam.
Like,
that's
this
my jam.
Is my raspberry
this is
jam.
My raspberry seedless jam. I don't approve of when people say, oh my gosh, I love Harley Quinn and the Joker's relationship and I wish that I had that kind of love with another person. When it gets to that point, I'm like, you really don't understand what their characters are actually about, because they have an incredibly toxic, dysfunctional relationship. The idea is that they are both very, very broken and very flawed, which is why I love them, because those are the characters that I kind of collect in my heart of hearts. All of the dysfunctional, I can't speak, dysfunctional broken characters are the ones that I love the most.
However, in Suicide Squad, they are not presented as that. Mm-hmm. They are presented as this perfect, albeit evil, couple.
They were literally being played as this high romance, which I really did love. I loved the way that they did certain moments. That, for example, there's kind of an origin of Harley Quinn thrown in there, which I thought was incredibly well shot. I thought the music was perfect. I thought cinematically it was beautiful. Visually, it was exactly what I wanted it to be.
But their motivations are quite clearly, I just have to be back together with them. Mm-hmm. And that's all it is. It's nothing more complex or more damaged or more interesting than, oh, I miss them.
There were scenes as well that were included that were more supposed to represent that. So it's unofficial. They haven't given like a statement to say that this is all true, but apparently there was a scene where Harley nearly shoots the Joker and the Joker kind of manipulates her and sweet talks her and she puts the gun down and then he hits her and then he sweet talks her again and then they end up having this embrace, this romantic embrace. Part of me, because I love their character so much, I would love to have seen some of these extra scenes back in the film, but part of me understands why they are not there. Because again, we go back to this idea of that already felt like there was too many things going on in this film and that it didn't know what it wanted to be. And much as I would love to have all this stuff of the Joker and all this stuff of Harley Quinn, it detracts from the actual film that it's trying to be, which is about the squad. I think ideally, the way that I would want it done, the way that I've thought a lot about this film since
perhaps,
I went to see it.
Perhaps too much.
But I think what would have been better is, rather than having all these little bits and pieces, I would have cut it down even more. I would have cut Jared Leto's involvement down in this film even more than it already is. Mm-hmm. And I would have given him an incredible moment in this film, like a take your breath away moment that just makes you go, oh my gosh, it's the Joker. And then I would have left it at that. Maybe part of her backstory, because then it's about her as a character, but keep him in the shadows at first and kind of keep him, you know that it's him, but it's this slow build up. Mm-hmm. Then have a moment in the middle of the film when literally it's like, I am here and this is me and I'm the Joker and I'm amazing.
It's that kind of surprise cameo, like Hugh Jackman's surprise cameo in the most recent X-Men film.
Strip it back so that it's not just these little weird intermittent scenes with him, and then keep the rest of him, all of the good stuff, till when you actually have a decent film where he's not just a cameo, where he's a co-lead in something. Mm-hmm. The editing that they did was not enough and it wasn't clever enough with him. They didn't handle the Joker very well, and that kind of upset me, because I really, really love the Joker as a character. I love Harley Quinn as a character and I wanted to know more about them. But if you can't give them all that time, which I don't think you could have done, I would have rather seen less.
I think if you look at Ghostbusters and you look at Suicide Squad, in both cases you have two films with massively high potential that have been impacted at the artistic level. They had really strong concepts and ideas. Clearly, you can see that in the films. but they've been adjusted, they've been generalized, they've been simplified to give them a broader appeal, but that's actually done the opposite.
Yeah, it's trying to please everyone, and by doing that, it pleases very few.
There you go. What would you give it as a score?
It's a hard one to score for me because it does, there are parts of it that I thought were brilliant, but then some parts of it that were really not great. I would give it 2.5. Right slap bang in the middle, 2.5. And that is literally because of the potential more than anything else.
1.5. She's wearing purple as well.
I am purple and green.
Very appropriate.
Yeah.
Next time we do this, we'll be sitting down and talking about 3 other films that we'll have seen. So we
Hopefully
will...
Hopefully if we can see 3 other films.
I think we'll see 3 other films.
But I hope you've enjoyed this. It's obviously a little bit different to what we usually do. But let us know if you're a fan. Maybe we'll make this a permanent segment that we'll do every so often because we love films. We love talking about films. Mm-hmm. And it's really fun to be able to share this with you. So let us know your thoughts. Give us a thumbs up if you liked the video. Yeah, this has been a very geeky episode of my podcast. So this feels like a very appropriate end to it.
Nice.
Yeah, high five.
High five.
As always, thank you so, so much for watching. You guys are amazing. I love you all. I will see you next week. I upload on this channel every Monday, and at the moment, I'm having lots of intermittent videos all over the place. So do subscribe to be notified as soon as I have a new video. But from me and from this handsome chap, we are going to head off and get some food.
Mm-hmm.
Exciting.
Watch another movie.
Yeah, another movie. Mm-hmm. But for now, I love you all. Thank you for watching. Have an amazing week. Happy sewing, happy knitting, happy geeky movie watching. And I'll see you all soon. Bye.
Bye.
Oh, actually, I just forgot something.
What?
You have to entertain them while I'm gone.
Okay.
What are you doing?
I was entertaining them whilst you were gone.